When we think of sepsis, immediately what springs to mind is infection. Correct? And we say infection ahe, tar mag patient la problems develop hou shakta. But that differentiation of patients who get infection to those who develop sepsis is not very clear. And then of course, those who develop sepsis, who may go on to deteriorate and go to ICU, that distinction also is not clear. And previously it has been defined and categorized. And once you see the categorization, it looks neat, but it is difficult to accomplish. So what we're going to see is the current definition. The definition has been changed in the year 2016. Though it has not been completely implemented, the definition has been changed. So let's look at what the current definition is. Okay, so the definition of sepsis we're going to look at, and we're going to look at what's meant by infection, what is meant by host response, what is meant by organ dysfunction. And then I've got four case studies, and we will look at those case studies. So here you can see sepsis. You have to have a source of infection. Then these bacteria may enter the blood, and when they enter the blood, they may leak out of the blood vessels, causing capillary leak, and they may result in organ dysfunction. And you can see the organs shown here. So they can cause cardiac dysfunction, so shock can occur. Then kidney dysfunction, so they can develop acute renal failure, acute kidney injury. Then they can develop liver failure. Liver failure is typically manifested by increase in the bilirubin and by the SGPT and SGOT. It's only in chronic liver dysfunction that you will get prothrombin time elevated or serum proteins which are low. But you know, if acute liver dysfunction is tending to become longer or it's tending to become fulminant, then you have to monitor the INR, which is the prothrombin time. And increase in the INR will be a sensitive indicator of whether patient is developing a hepatic failure. And then of course there are the lungs, and lungs may develop failure, so respiratory failure, and acute respiratory failure is usually manifested by hypoxia. The oxygen levels come in. And because the patient is conscious, now he tends to breathe fast and throw out the carbon dioxide. So primarily decrease in oxygen levels. And then of course you can get brain dysfunction. Very difficult to monitor, but we commonly use, what do we use to monitor brain dysfunction in the hospital? The Glasgow Coma Scale. Yeah, so we can use the Glasgow Coma Scale. Now when you put all these organs together, yeah, and you monitor their organ function sequentially, then what you get is called SOFA, Sequential Organ Functional Assessment Score. Okay? This is background to the new definition, because you need to know how we are going to define. Okay, so let's look at the definition. So this is the definition. It is life-threatening organ dysfunction that is due to a dysregulated host response. That means the host response is not normal. It is a dysregulated host response, and this has occurred in response to infection. Okay, so there are three components. Okay, life-threatening organ dysfunction, dysregulated host response, and infection. And you can see in this picture here that this is a WBC. WBC is not lysed. It's probably not functioning properly. There's a dysregulated host response. Okay. So now, you know, when we think of microorganisms, immediately what springs to mind is infection. And you're all very scared. And all the language that we use now is usually akin to the language used in war. Yuddha honar asa ta kasa apan bolto. Kasha prakarcha bacteria baddal bolto apan. Ata tyacha definition bagha kasa aahe na. This I have taken from the National Library of Medicine. Yeah. And they said it is the invasion. Mai kasa boundary asto. Pakistan, India madhe ala tasa. So it is the invasion of an organism's body tissues by disease causing agents. Mai bacteria clearly tyanna villain karun taklele. Pakistan karun. Their multiplication and the reaction of the host tissues to the infectious agents and the toxins they produce. And mag khali vegvegle toxins dakavlele dite. Streptococcus aahe, yersinia pestis aahe. Plague is a example, and plague म्हटलं की भीतीच वाटते लोकांना. कारण इन युरोप इट हॅड कॉज व्हॉट इज कॉल्ड ब्लॅक डेथ अँड इट हॅड वाईप्ड आउट नियरली 1/4 द वर्ल्ड पॉप्युलेशन ऍट दॅट टाइम. आणि आताही आपण बघितलं सुरतमध्ये जेव्हा प्लेग झालं होतं, पीपल वर एक्स्ट्रीमली स्केअर्ड बिकॉज दे वर वरीड दॅट इट वुड स्प्रेड. ओके, पण इम्पॉर्टंट विक्ट्रीज हॅव बीन वन इन बॅक्टेरियल इन्फेक्शन. Plague is one of them. It can be contained easily. We know how it spreads, and there's an antibiotic to treat it as well. Okay. So on the one hand, we have microorganisms which cause disease They invade the body, they invade the host tissues. The host tissues then produce a response, and this response, if it's an appropriate response, then the organism gets eliminated. But if it's an inappropriate response, or it is too strong, or it is too weak, then the resultant organ dysfunction can sometimes even relate to death. Okay. Now, this related concept is what is called a microbiome. So, the human microbiota is the aggregate of microorganisms that resides on or within any of a number of human tissues and biofluids, including the skin, mammary glands, placenta, seminal fluid, uterus, ovarian follicles, lung, saliva, oral mucosa, conjunctiva, biliary and gastrointestinal tracts. Okay, so contrary to common thinking, all these tissues in the body are inhabited by microorganisms. So there are bacteria in all these areas, and the residence of these bacteria within the human body is called microbiome or microbiota. Okay. And the estimate is that these bacteria in the human body, they outnumber the human cells. Previously the estimate was 10:1. So there are 10 times more bacteria in our body than there are cells. But now that estimate has become a little more conservative and people think it is closer to 3 times the number of cells. So if there are 1 trillion human cells in the body, there are 3 trillion bacteria. Okay? So we don't even have to think that we are going to defeat them or invasion whatever, because they outnumber us and they have been in evolution for a very, very long time. One more example that I would like to give you is that if you were to place the entire evolution of the earth on a calendar year, my January pasun suruvat zali ani December parent challe pravas. January manje jeva earth form hot hota, it was a molten ball of liquid metal and mag ti cooling suru zalo hota. So tya scale madhe January to December cha bacteria arrive somewhere around March. March pasun bacteria ta ani atta parent aahe may December parent. And humans, we want to take a guess how long humans have been there in this 1 year calendar. Less than 30 minutes. So we have been on this earth, if you were to compress the entire evolution, we have been there for only 30 minutes. And already we have threatened the earth and its existence by our intelligence. So now we need to use our intelligence to see that we do not result in the extinction of life as we know it on earth. So the bacteria have been there for very long. So the purpose of this lecture, the point I'm trying to make is the bacteria have been there for a very long time. We cannot outwit them very easily. And of the 30 minutes that humankind has been here, it is less than probably a minute that antibiotics have been there. And bacteria have already developed resistance to almost all known antibiotics. Okay, so I don't think that we will get anywhere by entering into a war with bacteria. We have to discover and find out how we interact with bacteria, how our body interacts with bacteria, and how this microbiome is beneficial. Not just beneficial, how it can be harmful. And then look at new ways in which we can further this cooperation with bacteria. Okay? So this is just an introduction. And you know, you might ask, how is it that we know this much about so many bacteria, and how didn't we know about it before? So this has been revolutionized now by a technique of mapping bacteria. It's called the RNA technique. So what is mapped of bacteria is their DNA and RNA. Deoxyribonucleic acid and ribonucleic acid. So using bacterial RNA, specifically 16S RNA, this what is called, this is a human genome project. You've heard of the human genome project, where all the genes in the body were mapped. So like that, there's a human microbiome project where all the microbiomes within the human body have been mapped. So now they've been mapped. And they are mapped using molecular techniques, genetic mapping techniques. So by mapping bacterial RNA and DNA, they have been mapped. And this picture here, So this small picture here, yeah, shows you the oral microbiome, it shows you the skin microbiome, it shows you this purple is a vaginal microbiome, and it shows you the fecal microbiome. And then what they've done is they've mapped these bacteria from the time of birth. So how do we acquire these bacteria? How do they come to be part of our body? So if there's a vaginal delivery, so bacteria are going to come first from the vagina. Okay? So the vaginal microbiome will predominate in the first few months of life. And then as time passes, no, through what they eat, the breast milk that they drink, and so on, they will begin to modify and arrive at their adult microbiome by the age of about 2 to 3 years. Okay? So that's a picture of the microbiome at the age of approximately 2 to 2.5. Eka bachula tani map kare. Tache je body madhe bacteria hote, te map karat 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 2 varsha paryant rahe. Kani ashe, there are many projects which are going on looking at the mapping of bacteria. And it's not just human beings. Huh? So they are all around us, in the air that we breathe, everywhere. And upon kasha interact karo. So it's very interesting. And that's why pustak mi tumhala dakhin. So if you are interested, you can read that book. Okay, so this is a little bit of background for this lecture. Huh? And just to put in perspective the role of bacteria. Okay. Now, the next is the host response. Okay. Now, you know, when we are looking at the definition of sepsis, we are saying, first of all, we said, is it infection or are these bacteria normally resident within the human body? Then we are looking at the host response, we are saying, is it a regulated host response, the normal immune response, or is it a dysregulated host response? And really, we are just touching the surface of this understanding. Okay, assume we don't have an understanding of how the normal immune response works. We don't know enough for us to say when it is going to get dysregulated. But there are beginnings, and you can see this is one study from critical care medicine, in which this nuclear factor kappa B was one of the factors that was identified, which may denote what is called a dysregulated host response. But we are still far away from using it as a marker for dysregulated host response. And the normal host response, so it's a network of cells, tissues and organs that work together to defend the body against attacks by foreign invaders. These are primarily microbes, again all language of war. Huh? Tiny organisms such as bacteria, parasites, fungi that can cause infection. Viruses also can cause infection, but are too primitive to be classified as living organisms. The human body provides an ideal environment for many microbes. It is the immune system's job to keep them out, or failing that, to seek out and destroy them. What is not said in this is that the development of the immune system, so the immune system now, the development of the immune system is critically dependent on these bacteria. And pahila jo babies ani aplya immune system la jo exposure milto to the outside environment is through the gut bacteria. And there is a very complex interaction between the bacteria in the gut and the developing immune system, which leads finally to the adult immune system. And if the bacteria are not there, supposing you raise bacteria free mice, ashe experiments aalele, so they develop a very deficient immune system. So like I said, now we are just touching the surface of understanding how we interact with our environment, and especially with bacteria. So this language, I think, is overtly military, and it represents little warped understanding, like aple Trump, tacha purvi Bush, vagere vagere. Huh? So we don't need to think of this military, and it is something in our minds that we have to change when we think of treating bacterial infections. Okay. So this part was a little bit of, you know, basic biology and understanding of infection. Now we are going to look at how we are going to arrive at the definition. And so, like I start, when I started, I told you that organ dysfunction we can look at using what is called the SOFA score. So SOFA is sequential organ function assessment. So there are 6 organs, and the next slide is going to show you how you can assess organ function. And QSOFA means it's a small SOFA score. In practice or in the wards, you can identify infection early. So for that, we use this QSOFA. Okay, so this is the SOFA score. And now, when you're going to recognize infection, we say that 2-point increase in the SOFA score above baseline will indicate organ dysfunction. And if that organ dysfunction is because of infection, then we will say that there is sepsis. Okay. So first is respiration. So I'm going to spend a little time on this slide so that you understand how we are going to do this. So respiration, if you are able to monitor the requirement for oxygen, then you know what we do is we commonly map what is called the PaO2 FiO2. आता हॉस्पिटलमध्ये पेशंट आला, त्याला आलेला लगेच ऑक्सिजन लावला आणि त्याचा पल्स ऑक्सिमीटर बघितला किंवा ब्लड गॅस पाठवला. सो इन द ब्लड गॅस वी सी व्हॉट इज कॉल्ड पीओ टू. ओके, पीओ टू, नॉर्मल पीओ टू इज बिटवीन 80 and 100 मिलीमीटर्स ऑफ मर्क्युरी. ओके, अँड एफ आय ओ टू इज द फ्रॅक्शन ऑफ इन्स्पायर्ड ऑक्सिजन इन एअर. द रूम एअर दॅट वी आर ब्रीथिंग इज 21%. येस, एव्हरीबॉडी नोज दिस फ्रॉम होम. सो वी आर ब्रीथिंग 21% एअर, अँड इफ आय से दॅट माय नॉर्मल पीओ टू ब्रीथिंग रूम इज 100, सो 20 मल्टीप्लाइड बाय 5. Correct. So there's a factor of 5. And in order to, you know, eliminate this effect of external oxygen or FiO2, we measure it as a ratio, PO2 FiO2. Or you can even use the SaO2 FiO2. So SaO2 FiO2 is the oxygen saturation. Okay? Now you can see here that normally if the PO2 is 100, yes, and the FiO2. Now FiO2 now is expressed as a percentage. It is 0.2, let us say. So 21% is 0.21. So if I divide 100 by 0.21, the 0.2 is how much is it? 2 upon 10, no? Correct. So it is 1 upon 5. So 100 upon 1 upon 5, that is equal to 500. So the normal PaO2 FiO2 ratio for all of us sitting here is 500. So greater than 400 you can see is normal. That gives you a SOFA score of 0 for respiration. So if it drops to 400, it gives you a SOFA score of 1. And you can see 221 to 301, that is the oxygen saturation divided by the FiO2. Now, oxygen saturation normally, I think I must show you this. So it's a small digression, because I just wanted to understand the relationship between PO2, FiO2 and saturation. Please bear with me for a minute. Let me just get that slide out. So when we are looking at oxygenation, we have to remember this curve. It's called the oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve from physiology. On the x-axis now you've got the partial pressure of oxygen. On the y-axis you've got the oxygen saturation. So it's a S-shaped curve, which indicates that it is flat at right at the end. The PO2 is 100. If PO2 is 100, then saturation is 100%. And as the PO2 drops from 100 to 60, the saturation drops only from 90 to 95. 100 to 95. Yeah, so, you know, for a relatively large fall in the PO2, there's a relatively small fall in the oxygen saturation. And this is a protective phenomenon. So, it ensures that we do not suffer from lack of oxygen. Okay, and then afterwards, you come to the steep portion. So, once the PO2 falls below 60, or the saturation is 90. So once it falls below 60, na, the saturation falls abruptly. Okay, so म्हणून आपण म्हणतो की पेशंटचा saturation 90 च्या वर ठेवायचा. So we are ensuring that there is no lack of oxygen. Okay, so now given this understanding, based on this, we've got this table. Yeah, and you can see here that in this table, the normal PO2 in millimeters of mercury is 80 to 100. The oxygen saturation is 95 to 100%. Yeah. And you can see the PO2 FiO2 ratio for a normal person, I've calculated it is 476. Okay? Now, as the PO2 drops, so PO2 is dropped to between 60 and 80, 60 to 79,
the oxygen saturation becomes 90 to 94%. Yeah, and if I calculate, say, for PO2 of 60, I calculate the PO2 effect ratio at 285. Okay, now if you remember, we go back to the SOFA score slide. If it's less than 300, you're going to get 2 points. Okay, mild hypoxemia. Then 40 to 59, the saturation is 75 to 89%, and you can see that the PO2 effect ratio has fallen to below 200. Yeah. And when it falls to less than 40, the PO2, saturation is less than 75, and if you're breathing room air still, then your PO2 effect ratio is less than 100. Okay, so you can see how the SOFA score will progressively worsen as the PO2 drops. Okay, and you can see that it's been correlated now for saturation also. So if you're going to really monitor it, say in your smaller hospital, or you don't need to do a blood test, you can use it. You can do the SOFA score using oxygen saturation. Then we've got coagulation. Now this 150 is the platelet count. So platelet count is more than 1.5 lakhs normally. If your platelet count is less than 1.5, you get 1 point. Less than 100, 2 points. Less than 50, 3 points. Now here obviously you can see a fallacy of the definition, which says a fallen SOFA score of more than 2 points. Dengue is a patient there. He is now nearing the end of first week, and his platelet count has fallen to 20,000. But otherwise, he's all right. He's got no other organ dysfunction. He's got only this one organ dysfunction. So we will not be able to define him or call him sepsis as we are trying to define it, because you need the other things as well. He's actually recovering from his infection. So therefore, you need to keep in mind that there will always be fallacies in the definitions that we provide. Okay. So, but this is based on platelet count. Then liver is based on bilirubin. Cardiovascular is based on the blood pressure, okay, of the mean arterial pressure. Then the Glasgow Coma Scale, that is based on the CNS dysfunction, is based on Glasgow Coma Scale, and the kidney dysfunction is based on creatinosis and fat lower costs. Okay, so come back, coming back to sepsis and the SOFA score for monitoring organ dysfunction. So there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 organs, and each organ dysfunction can be monitored. So for respiration, we are using the PO2, SiO2 or the SaO2, SiO2. For coagulation, we are using the platelet count. For liver, we are using the bilirubin. You can see the levels as the course photos are. For cardiovascular, we are using blood pressure. For CNS, we are using the Glasgow Coma Scale. And for renal, we are using the creatinine. Though sometimes, you know, using the creatinine may not be a very good marker, it's easier and better to use the urine output. So urine output would be an earlier and more sensitive marker. So one, the current definition for acute kidney injury, no? It incorporates both creatinine and drop in the urine output. And the drop in the urine output is monitored 6 hours, 12 hours, more than 12 hours. And it uses 0.5 ml per kg per hour and 0.3 ml per kg per hour. So it uses a very sensitive definition of urine output. Okay? And if you're able to pick up at the early stages, then you may be able to prevent pre-renal from becoming renal. And that's part of why we monitor organ dysfunction so closely. And for you also, because if you tackle it early, then you're going to be able to prevent organ dysfunction. Okay, so that's SOFA score. Next is the Q-SOFA score. The Q-SOFA score, you know, has been proposed as a score to pick up organ dysfunction early. And it's very simple. It uses only three parameters: respiratory rate, altered ventilation, and systolic blood pressure of less than or equal to 100. Okay. Now, unfortunately, you know, all these three may be present in other conditions as well. And so that may make the Q-SOFA too sensitive. And so you may get too many patients. Or sometimes you may miss sepsis. Nevertheless, this is what is recommended nowadays. Or do you know what was used previously to look at sepsis or to define sepsis? You know, what was the systemic inflammation response score? SIRS. Ekar organ dysfunction. But organ dysfunction आता बघितला. But early pickup करण्यासाठी we used to use SIRS. I'll come to that in a minute. I'll just show it to you because that is also equally important to understand. Okay. Before that, now we've seen what sepsis is. So three things: infection, dysregulated host response leading to organ dysfunction. Okay. Now, if this worsens, Then you get what is called septic shock. And septic shock is a subset of sepsis where there is circulatory, cellular and metabolic abnormalities and there is a high risk of mortality. So close to from 20 to 50%, no? That's the mortality of septic shock. And we say that septic shock exists despite adequate fluid resuscitation. So you've given more than 30 ml per kg body weight. As soon as you've diagnosed sepsis, you've given that much fluid and yet the BP is not coming down. You're requiring vasopressors, dopamine, to maintain the MAP above 65 or the systolic blood pressure above 90. And you've got lactate which is more than 2 millimoles per liter. So can you tell me why lactate would be used as an indicator or marker of severity of shock? So metabolism in the body can be described as aerobic and anaerobic. So if there is lack of oxygen to the tissue, the body switches from aerobic or oxygen driven metabolism to anaerobic metabolism, which is without oxygen. And whenever there is anaerobic metabolism, there is production of lactate. So when you get high lactate, it indicates to us that there is lack of oxygen. Okay, so if you have lactate more than 2, or you have need for vasopressors and a systolic blood pressure less than 90 or MAP more than 65, then you can see there is septic shock. Okay, and you can see that how the mortality is correlated with hypotension and lactate. So you can see if there is no hypotension or the lactate is less than 2, mortality will be 18%. But if you've got hypotension and the lactate is more than 2, then you've got 42% mortality. And this is a Western database. I think that our Indian database also will be similar. Only if, since we're not able to give uniform treatment to all patients, our mortalities may be higher. Okay, so I've finished the part where I'm defining the new definition, but I'm just going to put out some disadvantages so you understand what the thing is. So first is that it remains subjective. You know, we don't know what infection is, we don't know what dysregulated host response is, though we are measuring organ dysfunction by use of crude parameters, we still don't know how exactly to monitor it. Then qSOFA and SOFA are mortality predictors, they're not tests for sepsis. Sepsis 3 is less specific for infection than sepsis 2. qSOFA has similar performance compared to SIRS, so we're going to see SIRS. qSOFA may be less specific in disease that directly cause hypotension, tachypnea or delirium. qSOFA is inconsistent. qSOFA and SOFA is not evidence-based since it has not yet been validated in ICU patients. Okay, so let's go ahead. Many societies don't accept the new sepsis definition. No? There are these, but still, I think it's an important advance in our understanding of sepsis. Huh? Okay, now this is the old definition. So just to place to you in perspective, the old and the new. So you can see right on top, we've got systemic inflammatory response syndrome. So previously, what were we saying? We said infection plus two of the four criteria. And which are those four criteria? Temperature more than 38 or less than 36, pulse more than 90, respiratory rate more than 20, or PCO2 less than 32, or WBC count more than 12,000 or more than 10% immature band cells. So if you had two of these criteria, plus you had infection, then you could be said to have sepsis in the last definition. Whereas now the definition is dysregulated host response, organ dysfunction measured by the SOFA score and infection. Okay, so you've got organ dysfunction. Here you didn't have organ dysfunction. Just to give you an example of, you know, how or why this definition may over-diagnose sepsis. Atha, me, jina lift bandha padhi, me padhata ala vartti, mala thoda dhasa dhukhto, URTI zhali hai. And var padhata padhata yato hai, tachypnea zhali, tachycardia zhali. Heart rate more than 100 zhali, and respiratory rate more than 20 zhali. So do I have sepsis? Yes. So that's one of the disadvantages, that it over-diagnoses sepsis. So sepsis is first confirmed or presumed infection, mortality around 10 to 15%. Then, je attacha definition mane sepsis ahe, te magcha definition mane severe sepsis hota. With organ dysfunction. And then organ dysfunction is again hit target. Septic shock. So really, far difference nahi hai. Severe sepsis is now sepsis, SIRS has gone away. And you've got the qSOFA in its place. And septic shock is the same. Okay, so that's the new definition. So I'm gonna read it out because you can just quickly have a look. Okay. So some examples I've got.
So this is a 35-year-old patient, fever, severe abdominal pain, tachycardia, tachypnea, hypotension, decreased output, abnormal sensory.
So is this sepsis, septic shock,
or is it something else?
It could be sepsis if there is a source of infection. It could be septic shock if you've already given some fluids and you've got a source of infection. Because there's clearly organ dysfunction. My blood pressure low hale, output kami ahe, and abnormal sensory. So three organs dysfunction this way. So organ dysfunction ahe, but is that organ dysfunction because of infection? That would be the critical question to ask. So if I say along with this that the abdominal pain is in the left flank and there is associated burning micturition, then pyelonephritis, and then clearly it becomes sepsis. If on the other hand I say pain is in the epigastrium and is radiating to the back and the person is an alcoholic, so then pancreatitis, and pancreatitis is non-infective. Yeah, so it becomes a non-infectious cause for organ dysfunction. So whenever we consider whether this is, whether we want to start an antibiotic or not, we must always try to think of whether the organ dysfunction that is there is because of an infection or whether it is because of a non-infectious cause.
So this is the first case scenario I have for you. Okay, so we have said that sepsis septic shock is defined by the presence of infection, by organ dysfunction, and there may be important non-infectious organ dysfunction syndromes like pancreatitis, yeah, which may produce a picture like this. And treatment of this is these three things: resuscitation, identification of the source, and if the source is non-infectious, then please don't give antibiotics. And if you then think that it is infection and you need to use an antibiotic, then use an antibiotic appropriately based on what you think is the likely cause of infection. So two things determine the use of antibiotics. One is the source of infection, which body system or organ system is involved, and how is the host response? Has the host response been affected? Is the person immune deficient? Has he already received some antibiotics? Has he developed a nosocomial infection rather than a hospital acquired infection? So, you know, in your practice, you may see a patient who has been in Bharati Hospital for 3 weeks and then he's been discharged from hospital and then now he's come to the OPD to you with a syndrome like this. So there, if you start augmenting, it's not going to work. So you'll have to ask that person, ki tumhala kaya zhalto baba, tumhala pyelonephritis sathi admit kele hota ta, mag tumhala antibiotics kaya dile hote. And if you look at the discharge card, you'll find that all antibiotics in the world have been used. So such patients now are very difficult to treat. And they would be better off being sent back to the place of pain, because all the higher antibiotics or the reserve antibiotics will need to be given intravenously. Very, very rarely, there may be certain resistant infections, patient is otherwise stable, which you can sometimes treat with oral antibiotics. So for a resistant urinary tract infection, yeah, for which previous cultures have shown that it is resistant to all antibiotics, there you can use an antibiotic called fosfomycin. This is just an example. So you can use fosfomycin, which is an oral antibiotic, and you can give 3 doses and that may help to clear the infection. Okay, so all these things are important. So let's see the second case. 15-year-old girl comes to emergency department, high-grade fever, rash, respiratory rate 28, pulse 120, BP 110, 70. System normal. Now, if I were to consider the previous definition of sepsis, then I will say that the pulse is high, the respiratory rate is high. So I've got 2 out of 4 criteria, and she's got high grade fever and rash. So she probably has got some viral syndrome. And so this could be, yeah, but I might say that this is sepsis. Well, it may not be sepsis. Patient may be otherwise well, you know. The moment you give a paracetamol, the heart rate will come down to below 100 and the respiratory rate also will come down. So you will be cautious about saying that this is sepsis with organ dysfunction. So organ dysfunction bhautik nahi hai, even though her tachycardia and tachypnea is there. So this is probably infection, and the infection may be because of a viral risk where an antibiotic is not required. Okay. So supposing now for this patient you were to do the hemogram, and the hemogram comes back as hemoglobin of 16%, 16 grams. The WBC count is 4,500, and platelet count has come back as 90,000. Wait and watch, and your likely diagnosis becomes dengue fever
because there's hemo concentration, WBC count is normal, and platelet count is low. So you send the NS1 antigen. Now we've got the facility. No? NS1 antigen comes back positive. Yeah. Then you're justified. In fact, it is, I won't go so far as to say it's medical negligence to give an antibiotic in a situation like this. So here, should not use an antibiotic. So don't use antibiotics now for clearly defined viral illnesses where you've got a positive diagnosis, NS1 positive viral illness. So don't use antibiotic in such situations. Third example, this is a hospital example now, just short example, so don't worry. So elderly male shifted to ward after thrombolysis for stroke. He develops confusion. Respiratory rate is 25. BP is 96 over 70, pulse is 90 per minute, SpO2 is 92%. So now in this example, if I were to use the qsofasfor, if you remember, qsofasfor had three parts. One was respiratory rate, second was altered sensory med, low blood pressure. So this person, and he's elderly, you know, so his blood pressure must have been previously hypertensive, and he's got stroke also. So the BP has come down to less than 100. The RR is 25 more. And he's developed confusion. So here I would strongly suspect that this may indicate infection. Now, confusion, I should be able to say, now if I said he's a stroke, so I say that he was a left-sided stroke and he did not have any speech abnormality and his sensorium was normal before this. So this is new onset confusion. So new onset confusion with respiratory rate high and blood pressure low, the qsofasfor score is high, and what possible infection could he have? No, he's elderly male shifted to ward after thrombolysis for stroke. Yeah, so he's been given TPA and he's now seventh day in the hospital. Central line. Asha patient saathi aami central line nahi ghalnar. Karan garaj nahi hai central line. Which infection are you thinking of? Pneumonia is a possibility because he may be bedridden, not walking around, so hypostatic pneumonia or urinary infection. See, very likely urinary infection. Such elderly people will generally have some amount of prostatic, yeah, so retention may be there. Second possibility is that he may have been catheterized. So if I change the scenario a little bit, I said elderly male who presents to your emergency department after being admitted in the hospital for 10 days for stroke, where he was thrombolized. Then he doesn't have the catheter also. So then you have to ask, are you catheter hota ka hospital madhe? And he tumhala antibiotic wagere dile hota ka discharge card varti baghayche. And mag kutla antibiotic ide choose karayche. So this is highly likely that this is a infective, yeah, and probably urinary infection. Okay, last case study. So now this is the case we actually have in our hospital at the moment, and it really represents some of the most difficult problems that we treat. So she's a lady with myasthenia gravis. She's on the ventilator for the last 4 months. And now she developed tachycardia, tachypnea, altered sensorium when she was on the ventilator, and she developed loose motions. And she's been previously treated for multi-drug resistant urinary tract infection, CLABSI, and hospital acquired pneumonia. She has an antibiotic coated line. So we're not thinking of the line as the source of infection. Chest X-ray is normal. And the C. diff toxin assay is negative. So you all know the C. diff toxin assay? C. diff is Clostridium difficile. It's an organism which grows nosocomial, normally present in the intestines, but when all the other intestinal bacteria get knocked off by multiple courses of antibiotics, the Clostridium difficile overgrows. So there's an overgrowth of Clostridium difficile, and it causes what we typically describe as antibiotic associated colitis. Yeah, and it can cause diarrhea also. So even though the C. diff toxin assay is negative, this could still be Clostridium difficile infection. Okay. And so now we come back full circle with this last example. So, how do we treat Clostridium difficile infection? Yes, you can give oral metronidazole or you can give oral vancomycin. Yeah. So, that helps to kill off the bacteria. But there is an alternate approach. So, can you imagine what the alternate approach could be? You're in the right direction. So, you want to populate or repopulate all the bacteria that you've killed off in the intestine by giving multiple courses of antibiotics with normal bacteria. But kind of the lactobacillus is the one that we give by mouth is not a usual resident of the flora. So you want to give a representative thing of the intestinal flora. So the, yes?
Prebiotic, probiotic.
Prebiotic, probiotic. Again, you know, that is very restricted. and it is looking at giving a few bacteria. So if you want to give all the bacteria,
Herd
doesn't have all the bacteria, it's got only lactobacillus. So what you have to do, and this is a recent approach, is you have to give or do what is called a fecal transplantation. I can't tell you fecal transplantation. You've heard of it. So fecal transplantation is where all the intestinal flora are taken. They are carefully purged of possible pathogens, and then it is given through the Ryle's tube or as an enema. As an enema. And what do you think the cure rate would be for postural diffusive if you give such a thing?
100%.
Almost 100%. It's more than 90%. And it is shown in a randomized controlled trial. So, you know, like I said, that's why I said I'm coming back full circle. I'm saying that we're trying to kill off bacteria, whereas there may be approaches to treatment which may involve the giving of bacteria. And you all are on the right track by saying probiotics. And this fecal transplantation is at other end of the spectrum. Okay, so these are the common pitfalls, and they are pitfalls for us really, but they may apply to your practice in the ICU as well. So, you know, treating non-infectious or non-bacterial causes with antibiotics and promoting the growth of resistant bacteria. Choosing the wrong antibiotics, not paying attention to PKPD. So, this lecture was not about choosing the right antibiotic. We can have a lecture on that some other time. Then, not paying attention to PKPD. PK is pharmacokinetics and PD is pharmacodynamics. Now, you know, the brain has got a blood-brain barrier. So if I have an antibiotic which does not cross the blood-brain barrier, I can't use it to treat meningitis. So therefore, you have to have knowledge of the pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics so you can decide which antibiotic to use there. Then not sending cultures. So treating blindly is all right for the first few days, but afterwards you should be able to target your antibiotic. You should not be, you know, randomly killing off all the microorganisms. So, you know, it's like, example is that you want to pick off one terrorist and you use a nuclear bomb in the city. So, sagyarna marunayasa. Sagay, all inhabitants, animals, everybody dies. The terrorist also dies, but everybody dies in the bargain. So, using antibiotics is akin to using a nuclear bomb. Okay. Then, not de-escalating antibiotics readily for too long. Not doing source control. So, if you give antibiotics and you don't take care of the source, then patient will not improve, and not preventing nosocomial infections. Okay, so this is a quote I have got for you. And Louis Pasteur is widely defined as the father of medical microbiology. And he said that the microbe is nothing, it's actually the terrain of the milieu. And the terrain of milieu, it includes bacteria, huh? Not just the body. Okay, I have given you this metaphor of life on Earth that is there only for the last 30 minutes, and the power of bacteria. So this is one book which I recently read about a month back, which has really inspired my understanding and has deepened my understanding of microbes. So you all can get it from the net. I don't know if you'll use Kindle. तर किंडलवरती मिळून जाईल पुस्तक आणि अमेझॉनवरती किंवा ह्याच्यावरती हार्ड कॉपी पण मिळेल. सो इट्स कॉल्ड आय कंटेन मल्टीट्यूड्स द मायक्रोब्स विदिन अस अँड द ग्रँडर व्ह्यू ऑफ लाईफ. अँड देन दीज आर टू टेक टॉक्स. द वन दॅट आय टोल्ड यू अबाउट द मायक्रोबायोम ना, या, सो दॅट्स द टॉप वन. सो दिस रॉब नाईट, या, ही वॉज द डायरेक्टर ऑफ द मायक्रोबायोम प्रोजेक्ट. अँड how our microbes make us who we are. So it's a very nice 15 minute talk on TED, on this. Have you heard of TED Talks? Yeah. So you can look at that. And this Jessica Green is, are we filtering the wrong microbes? This is a message for hospitals. Often that sort of sterile environment karayacha prayatna karto, but in doing that, trying to prepare that sterile environment, we only end up keeping the normal microbes out, and those sterile environments may tend to promote the growth of nosocomial or resistant bacteria. Okay? I think that's my last slide. Thank you.